स्क्वाड्रन लीडर राकेश शर्मा, सारे राष्ट्र का ध्यान आपके तरफ है और हम सब आपको बधाई देते हैं। यह एक ऐतिहासिक कदम है। मेरी आशा है कि इससे हमारा देश अंतरिक्ष के प्रति जागरूक होगा और साथ ही हमारे युवकों को साहसिक कार्य करने की प्रेरणा मिलेगी। प्रश्न तो आपसे बहुत से पूछने हैं, लेकिन थोड़े ही से पूछती हूँ। जमीन पर तो आपकी ट्रेनिंग बहुत कठिन रही और एक वैसा ही वातावरण बनाया गया जैसे कि अंतरिक्ष में होता है। अब आप वास्तव में अंतरिक्ष में हैं, तो क्या वैसी ही हालत है या कुछ अलग लग रहा है?
पहले तो मैं भारत के नागरिक होने के नाते आपको धन्यवाद देता हूं और मेरे क्रू मेंबर्स भी मेरे साथ आपको धन्यवाद देते हैं आपकी बधाई के लिए। जैसे आपने कहा, हमारी ट्रेनिंग बहुत रवीश मल्होत्रा की और मेरी दोनों की ट्रेनिंग काफी मुश्किल थी, मगर अभी हमें आके पता लग रहा है कि ये जो ट्रेनिंग हमें मिली, ये ट्रेनिंग जरूरी थी, क्योंकि जब ही हमारी डॉकिंग मनूवर हुआ है बगैर किसी तकलीफ के, हमें तो ऐसे लगा जैसे कि हम सिमुलेटर में ही बैठे हुए हैं। तो ये हमें सब बताता है कि जो ट्रेनिंग हुई है, कड़ी ट्रेनिंग, इसकी जरूरत थी, जिसकी वजह से हम बगैर किसी तकलीफ के सक्सेसफुल डॉकिंग कर पाए हैं।
ऊपर से भारत कैसा दिखता है आपको?
जी, मैं बगैर किसी झिझक के कह सकता हूँ कि सारे जहाज से अच्छा।
I'm told that you got into the cockpit of an aircraft for the first time when you were just 6 years old. And that was when your uncle?
My cousin, yeah.
Your cousin was passing out from Air Force in Hyderabad. Is that the moment that triggered the journey?
Yeah, you see, he invited us to attend his passing out parade. He was getting his wings and he was joining the Air Force as a fighter pilot. And before he made me sit in the cockpit, there was a flypast, and I was totally enamored by these vampires. It was the first time that jet engines were flying in Indian airspace. So it was making that whistling sound. And of course, I looked up, and then he said, "Come, I'll make you sit in this same aircraft cockpit." And I couldn't believe my luck. So he made me sit in that aircraft, and I saw the array of dials, etc. And it captured my imagination, and it stayed with me ever since.
So, as a young, Rakesh Sharma always wanted to join the Indian Air Force.
Yeah.
I'm also being told that, your father was from Multan in Pakistan, and the mother, now infamous for the Osama bin Laden incident.
He's from Abbottabad.
So,
yes.
Yeah. So, and you came to India after the partition, and apparently you made an attempt a couple of years back. Now your mother is 94.
Yeah, she's 94.
So you wanted to take your mother back to Pakistan.
Yeah.
So that you can go and see the roots, where all that. And what happened? Pakistan denied, or what was it?
Yeah, so I wanted to organize a nostalgia trip for my mother. This was after I lost my father. And so I applied for a visa with Air Headquarters' help. But at that time, relations between our countries were not the best. There was some cricket diplomacy being planned, and there were thousands of visas, Indians going to Pakistan and Pakistanis coming to India. So somehow they've said that for you, because by then I was India's cosmonaut, they said your visa application will have to be dealt with personally in Islamabad. And it probably got lost in the spate of visa applications that were filed by spectators who were part of this cricket diplomacy. So it got lost, and And
can we start a campaign? Get Rakesh Sharma back to Pakistan.
I have been back to Pakistan in 71 war, you know, but from the flight. But my mom is too old to travel now.
Do you still keep that? You still have that that dream of taking your mother to Pakistan if everything happens, if the visa comes through?
I would love to do that, but you know, she has mobility problems now, and I don't. She doesn't like to be dependent, right. And so I don't know whether she'll accede to my request if I were to make it again.
All right. So I'm also being told that, you know, you became an Air Force pilot at the age of 21. And just around 48, 50 hours of flying, at the age of 23, you participated in the 1971 war. 2 years into Air Force, 50 hours of flying, how was it?
Going in.
Well, it was, like I said, I wasn't probably the most confident, macho fighter pilot of the Indian Air Force, but point is that every fighting man who's in uniform has always waited for the opportunity to bring his training into practice, and I was very fortunate that despite being quite inexperienced, I was given the go-ahead to fly in that war. And I flew 21 missions, so.
Yeah. So looks like everything came into your life very, very early.
Yes, it did.
21 Air Force within 2 years, war. And after that, you know, at a very young age, you became an experimental test pilot.
Well, yeah. First, I became a production test pilot with 5 years' experience. And then I became an experimental test pilot with 8 years' experience. And I've been in testing ever since. Well, till I had my last flight in the Mirage 2000.
All right. So let's break this straight away to the young team of future warriors of HAL, Prashant and team. One question.
What message would you impart to the design team youngsters, especially the youngsters of HAL, as their role in taking the country's aerospace game forward? Of course, Kota sir is here, he has been guiding us, but I would specifically like to know from my executive, what does he expect us and what way we should move forward?
Last week I was in HAL Nasik. There was a gathering of ex-chief test pilots. Wing Commander Ashoka was there. He was the senior most, and there were about 8 of us. And we had a seminar out there where we spoke, but that was related to the production testing in HAL. And I would again say that when it comes to development work, the message, I mean, if I were to be a part of a development team today, again, I've had the privilege of being with, working under Kota sir during the Tejas project. I would like to see a lot more participation between the flying test flyers and both the program managers and the designers than it was earlier, up till now. And I don't have much experience. I was there on the IJT till we froze the cockpit design. And after that, I don't know. I've not kept pace with what's going on. But I think the concept of working in a team has not fully been, it may have been understood, but I don't know today. So let me put a disclaimer. I don't know how things are today, so let me not prejudge the situation. So it's not as well as I would have liked it to be. If it has improved, well and good. If it has not, well, this is just an observation of the past.
In fact, Prashant and his team has captured the imagination of India, a young team, really, really toiled hard to get that flying machine out. Thank you so much, Prashant. I want to know, you talked about your mother sometime back, and what did she say? Did she okay it? Because ultimately, in Indian setup, you have to get that one university certificate from mother to do everything, right? So when you were selected to go to space, USSR, all that, what was it? What was that mother-son conversation? She was all right or emotional? Or
actually, things moved so fast, and everything was so hush-hush because we were supposed to be positioned in Star City before Mrs. Gandhi arrived. And because she was supposed to break the news to India and the world that India has agreed to send a guy up in space. So I didn't get to speak with my mother that this is what was happening. But what she told me was much earlier when I had a difficulty getting her consent for my parents to allow me to fly fighter aircraft, because we didn't have any other family member, extended family relatives in the services, except for that cousin of mine, and who died in an air crash 2 months after he got commissioned.
You're so basically from a teaching fraternity, right?
Well, my mom was an educationist.
Your father was a Sanskrit pundit?
No, my father was with the Punjab National Bank earlier, and then he switched to state government service. So there's no military influence at all, except for the vampire aircraft in Indian skies.
So what did your mother finally say?
So mother said that I don't want to stand in the way. You seem to be adamant. She thought I would grow out of it, but I didn't. So she says, I don't want to stand in the way, but I'm just asking. I want you to promise only one thing, that you will be good in whatever you do. Because in her thinking, in this kind of game, if you have to be good, you'll be safe, you know, because you've got to be a step ahead of the game. So that was her way of making me promise that I would not grandstand, I would be the kind of professional we talked about.
All right, so, you know, I was just 11 years old in 1984, April, the
3rd of April.
And my mother was an English teacher, and she said after that, you must become Rakesh Sharma, you must go to the space. And, you know, yeah, we went into different kinds of spaces, but not there. But, you know, it's surprising that a country of 1.4 billion, you're the only one man who went to space.
Yeah, don't make me feel more guilty than I already do. Yes, it is. But there's a reason for that. And that is because ISRO was working to a very carefully crafted plan by the likes of Vikram Sarabhai. And that was that all our effort in space must have a socio-economic focus, and everything must trickle down to the common man. So ISRO was busy realizing that vision of Dr. Sarabhai. And therefore, there was no spare bandwidth. And actually, I don't have his quote on the slide. So he very clearly stated right at the beginning that we are not in competition with any other nation. We are only focusing on this bit. And I must say that ISRO has stuck to its plan and achieved spectacular success. And so that is why they were not interested in the space flight. We still don't have a manned space program. So, and that is the reason why nobody else went. So my flight, although it was scientific in content, but it had political aims, which were realized by that one flight.
All right, so from Poorna Prajna School, can we have one question? Yeah, one question, just one. Yeah, give the youngster a chance, the young boy. Quickly, mics, we have to save time. Yeah. You identify yourself with your name and ask him.
I'm Suhas Aligar, a student of Poorna Prajna Education Center. And today, instead of calling you a cosmonaut, I would like to call you a survivornaut. My question is that after returning from space, the Vaimonauts will have to face many problems, that is space sickness. And I heard that you practiced yoga to overcome all this, and you had introduced the Indian food to the Russian astronauts nationally in the space, and you were the first Indian to do that. Can you say more about that, sir?
Yeah, so one problem with space flight is that you have a lot of people become less productive in space because of symptoms of space sickness. So this has been a problem since man started going into space and started living in that environment of zero gravity. So therefore, there was always research going on how to alleviate these symptoms. How can we better train our crews so that they are not hit by these symptoms? And one of the ideas was that let's try to prepare space crews as per the yogic method. So the other two crew members who were with me, they were Russians. They continued training as per their profile. And about 2 months, 3 months before the launch, I stopped training as per their profile and I did only yoga to check whether it is that this yogic system is efficacious, whether it will help in solving that problem. Now, as it turned out, the other two were experienced cosmonauts, so they adjusted pretty well to zero gravity. And I had no problem either. So I'm unable to say whether it was because of yoga. The data sample size is too small. I could have been one of those guys who wouldn't have ever had a problem anyway. Not everybody feels airsick. Not everybody feels car sick. I could have been one of those guys because I've never felt airsick in my life. So did the yogic asanas, prepared as per that. Even in space, I didn't do those exercises which were prescribed for the Russians. I just did yoga. And, well, I was none the worse for wear.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah, Indian food. So, see, we took every opportunity to learn. So we did know that maybe there was in our minds at some far-off date some manned program ideas. So we decided to experiment the Defense Food Research Laboratory in Mysore. They are the one?
DFRL.
DFRL.
Like there are two there.
Yeah. So they are the ones who came up. The standards are pretty high because of microbial infections which can happen. That is one. And secondly, the method of preparation. Because if you're going to have rice in space, then each grain needs to stick with the other one. Otherwise, the whole environment inside, you'll have grains of rice floating around. So.
All right, thank you. That's it, yeah. So wherever, we are always, like Indians, worried about khana, kaisa mila.
Sapad,
yeah. So, Indians are experts in this chori chori chupke chupke types, right, experts. Did you smuggle anything to them? I understand, you're supposed to carry X, Y set of things and all that. There are standard things to be carried. But and we are very religious, superstitious, all that thing. Did you, when I say smuggle means not, kuch na kuch kiya hoga?
Yeah. So we took some amrit with us in the form of cognac. Since we were not going to Kerala.
Yeah.
But that is, it's traditional that when a new crew goes to the laboratory,
All right. They
take a padarak or the gift
All right. For
the resident crew in the laboratory. So we smuggled some cognac.
All right. So how is it, in the sense, is there any difference between seeing dreams in space and Earth? Yeah, kuch farak hai, like 4G, like 3G types?
Now, I used to dream in color when I was young. Later on, I think it just kind of became black and white. And later on, it just stopped. So I think by the time I went to space, I never used to dream. Or at least, probably my memory was failing. I never could remember the dream the next morning. So I don't know what it was. Even if I had dreamt in space, I don't remember.
All right. So did you take... I understand that you took some cassettes, songs. So you guys used to sing there, dance, or listen to music?
No, well, we did have a guitar on board.
All right.
And we were allowed to carry 1 kg of personal stuff. So I carried this cassette player and a cassette of my favorite music.
So what was that music?
Oh, I like all kinds of music, from Hindustani classical to English to Sufi, so all kinds of music, English.
I understand when you guys were there, you had some friends visiting, first time in the history of space, other group that came from the U.S.
Well, we have a record of sorts in our name, because there were three guys in the Salyut laboratory. Three of us went in the Soyuz. We docked with the Salyut. So six of us were in the Salyut.
One Indian, five Russians.
One Indian, five Russians.
And the U.S. guys came.
And the U.S. guys got airborne in the shuttle from the States. So that at that time, there were 11 human beings of different race and color orbiting planet Earth.
First time? It has never happened after?
No, I've not been following the record books. Right. I don't know whether that has happened again, but it's unlikely to have happened again.
Right.
Because shuttle has gone out of service. And
11 people in space, that's a huge traffic.
Huge traffic. Yeah. Huge, nothing compared to Bangalore.
Yeah. Bangalore, Bangalore, we experiment. This is an experimental state.
Yeah.
So anything that happens, we experiment here. Over to Shichugriha. Where are you guys? Yeah. Quickly.
I would like to ask you, sir, do you have any regrets looking back at your career?
Oh, my God, no. If it hadn't been for my career, I wouldn't have gone to space. I have absolutely no regrets. And if I were to live my life again, I would become a fighter pilot, try to become. I hope that it still remains an interesting job, what with automation and artificial intelligence.
Not embarrassing to you if I ask this question. Even, a lot of people have gone through. I understand that you failed in mathematics in NDA.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I didn't fail. I came down in flames.
Any maths teachers here? Yeah. Okay, so what was that?
Well, maths was never my favorite subject. English literature was, English language was, biology was. But, that such is life. If you want to get where you want to be, then, and if you've entered this kind of profession, then you naturally would like to aim for the top. And the route to that was to become a test pilot. And test pilot, during the course, I did a master's level aeronautical science, which was, there was maths coming out of my ears. But I did manage to finish that course.
All right, sir. NPS, CMI NPS, yeah. Please identify yourself. Why is it all the boys are asking questions? Yeah. We want some Nari Shakti questions coming up.
Yeah, right. there are women fighter pilots in the Indian Air Force now.
Yeah, all right.
How did it feel when you were in space as a part of the cosmos?
Let me put it in context. The first man started going to space from Gagarin's time, and that was so new at that time, and I was in school, senior school, that I was totally captivated by this new vertical which had come up, and not only me, my entire generation, and at that time, remember, there was no wall-to-wall television, there was just the print medium, and absolutely everything used to be written. What these guys ate for breakfast, what they had for lunch, etc., etc. So all of us followed very closely the way astronauts would train, what they saw. Then Life magazine came out with those photographs. Then videos came out. And I was the 128th guy to go into space. So there was a lot of material already available, both in the print, audio, and visual medium. So one was pretty much prepared for what to expect. But still, it does take your breath away when you go up there. Because there is, like I was saying, there has not yet been a camera capable of the same acuity of your eyes, So what you see in real life will always have a lot more detail and texture and color than even a 3D photograph.
All right. Now, your speech covered a lot of advices for the youngsters. So I would just want to ask you something very, something which I'm close to, something which Guru Kalam was also close to, something what Dr. Kota keeps telling us what we should do. He's a mentor. And today's youth, children, you know, they're gadget fancy and, you know, I wouldn't say slaves of technology, all of us are, but then...
Slaves
of technology, sorry for that. And, you know, like even I am one, so, you know, I got the membership much before you. You came later. So the thing is that, you know, and he dreamt of India becoming 2020 a developed nation. And all of us know by 2040 also it's not going to happen the way at which we are wasting time on Facebook, on WhatsApp, and, you know, on whatnot. And you get into the homes, you know, there is nobody talks. It's all like one very absolute mess where the father is mother. Everybody is communicating. But don't you think as a nation, there has to be, we waste a lot of time. And what can you tell these people, you know, but we need to respect time. We need to, you know, right from morning, making the bed to, that system has to be in place. All these things doesn't matter. You know, did it concern you, considering that you have been traveling across schools and colleges, giving lectures, corporates, engineering colleges? So what is that you found with this group? Out of 10, how many marks you will give them for time management?
Things we can do for ourselves, we do not. And I think the problem is that we have stopped demanding excellence. And really speaking, you got to do it yourself. We can't wait for the government to do it for us. And all it takes is cooperation. You just change the world around you. And there are so many of us that when we stand together, we've changed the country.
Right. So my first question, sir, social media.
Social media. Well, I think we have to appreciate the fact that technology has provided us with the means, but we still retain the choice of what content we see. Okay, so that choice is yours. You cannot blame technology for jamming your bandwidth. You have chosen to jam your bandwidth. It's the same technology which can provide for you content from National Geographic, Discovery. There is so much that is available. There's Wikipedia in the print medium. There's so much. It depends what you choose. If you're going to be busy in expanding your knowledge base, well, you're equipping yourself for the future. Because remember that it is not change which is going to trip us, it is the rate of change. Because technology is galloping everywhere else. And if you're going to be even jogging at the same place, you will still get left behind. You've got to be ahead of the game at all times. And this is, we are already moved into a knowledge society. So there's no time to waste, there's no time to answer inane WhatsApp messages. It is eating into your time. That's all. Choice is yours.
My question is, when you first reached space, what was the first thought that came into your mind?
Yeah, so we were talking about this yesterday evening. like everybody else who goes into space, the first thing you do when you look out the window is you look for your country. So you look at your country and, you know, you say, it's quite like what the geography books have said it would look like. So, and then you get used to seeing it over and over again because there are 17 to 18 orbits every day. Of course, you don't fly over your country on each orbit. But when you shift your focus, now you want to see the neighboring countries. And then you start realizing from there that boundaries are not visible, that they were man-made. And then you start developing that global outlook. And then things become so irrelevant. The rivers of blood which have been shed over conflicts to protect small pockets of resources. So, I mean, these are the thoughts which come because it's a vast universe out there. You know, we we forget to recognize our place in the universe because we are busy.
Our duty, apart from teaching, is inspiring students. But of late, I feel that the efforts taken by us to inspire students are not working 100%. One thing I want to tell you here, that you talked about Michael Jordan.
Talked about?
Michael Jordan.
Yeah.
The basketball player, having so many failures and being succeeded. I feel the students are referring it in the wrong way. When I say you have to succeed, they say, ma'am, this is the stage where we are failing. So you succeed later. So that is actually motivational, I mean, demotivating us as a teacher, because we get to see them only till 12th standard. After that, we have no touch with them. But we would always pray that they should come up in life. But the casual, the amount of casualness is increasing. So I would just like it, there's a saying, when water comes from Senku, it is called Tirtham. So I take you as a Senku here.
God.
Maybe if you speak, they get inspired. Thank you.
You know, I must tell you, let me put it in perspective. My seventh grade school teacher, I used to always be in trouble, and most of the time I used to be standing on the last bench, punished. So one day he called me aside and he said, you know, Rakesh, I really worry for you. The rate at which you're going, you know, you're the only one job you'll be capable of doing, standing outside General Post Office with your tongue hanging out so that people can stick stamps onto their letters. He told me that. And believe me, if I had not had a passion and if I had not chased it after convincing my parents, I would have been standing outside GPO today. So really, I think what we really need to do is, again, I'll tell you about my own son. There was a software available in the West. He was studying in a school which had a very good teacher-student ratio. And that lady came. She was one of the parent of one of the students from America. And she told this class to take the test, basically to identify the aptitude. So in my son's case, it came out blank. He was interested in too many things, you know. But I think that is what tomorrow's child needs to be. He cannot remain in a silo, become a super specialist. You've already heard of Internet of Things, you know. That there's going to be a convergence of technologies. And if you're going to have a broader picture, then you're a winner. You'll be relevant. So if you feel that the students today, you're unable to motivate them and engage with them, please don't misunderstand. You got to find a new vocabulary, a new language. You got to first find out where they are living inside their heads. And start that dialogue. And then probably continue counseling them. But then you know what you're dealing with. Otherwise, we are all, you know, shooting arrows in the dark.
All right. So over to Advocate Nagu Roja, granddaughter of Guru Kalam.
Hello, sir.
Hi.
I have only one question. Can you guide all of us, how to set pace with technology without losing our ethical values?
I think you're alluding to the easy availability, because technology is an enabler, right? But all through our lives, even if you look back, there were ways and means of corrupting yourself. There were always bars, there were always notch girls, everything was the same. Only thing is, it's now easier, available easily, right? So, but you still have to exercise your choice. The problem that is happening today, according to me, is the real problem is the economic model our planet follows, which is quarter-on-quarter growth, you know, inflation, which has to be there, keeps increasing, education, which is getting expensive, medicine, which is getting expensive. So instead of mother remaining at home, you have to have a double-income family. When you have a double-income family, there is no transference of values from the parent to the child. In fact, both the parents are so busy working to earn a livelihood to be able to give a better future to their children, except that it's so expensive today to do that. So I think that is what is happening. So earlier, your parents were forever breathing down. They were the CCTV cameras. So you couldn't hide from anything from them. Today, both are busy. There is no baatcheet.
Yeah.
You're not together or even on the dinner table.
Can you just guide, sir, to find out that how a child can find out in his life that what he wants to be?
I think the basic questions which children need to ask themselves is, what do they find challenging? See, if you don't have a challenge in front of you, it's unlikely you will remain engaged. So if you have a challenge, and in fact, what you don't want to do is a very good thing to ask yourself, why don't you want to do it? You know, and that brings me to the point that there are many a time in my own career when I felt, my God, there is no way I'll be able to fly this supersonic aeroplane. I mean, but then when I did do it, I found that it's not half as difficult as I thought it would be. So first, find out what is it that you don't like, and then why don't you like it, and maybe then go along that line. But I take your point. It was much easier for me because I was hooked at that age. And I also know, see, we are suffering from, there are too many choices. In the olden days, they were just... Like in the olden days, there was just Doordarshan. Now you don't know which channel to go to. So. But nevertheless, I think if you don't look at a career as a, like I said, as a means of making money, but if you want to look at it as what will fulfill you, what is challenging for you, because if it is challenging, you will remain engaged with it and you will realize your potential in that line. I mean, that's what I think. I really don't have a good answer to your very good question.
Sir, today India has come a long way. You have very intelligent students. But in spite of that, we feel that the students do face, undergo some inferiority complex when they are together with Europeans or Americans. And way back, you were with five Russians. So did you go through any such complex, or did you feel that you were...
Again, I was at an advantage. You know, when you have the tricolor on your arm, what happens is that your performance goes beyond your potential. Because that... So that is why I said, it's like having a purpose higher than yourself. And when you have that, things become a lot easier. So you're talking about the Russians. Well, the only thing that was in my mind at that time was that you cannot let down the country, the Air Force. You're out there in a different environment, yes, but that's how it is. And you find the reserves then. To come up with the goods. In fact, I would say this continued later on when in the Tejas program, sir, and you will probably be in a better position to answer this, because again, with very, very limited experience, we were dealing with cutting-edge technology and we were shoulder to shoulder with foreigners, and at no stage we found, of course, trepidation was there, we were worried that, you know, we might fall short of delivering. But when we did, we found they are as dopey as us, and they are as brilliant as us. They are as prone to mistakes as that's what has been our experience. They've got better processes, yes, but our common sense, our core intelligence, was at par, or if not better.
The last question to the guru, guru quota. Yeah, to you know, you can ask one question.
Of course, there are a lot of issues, problems, ethics, and all. But I do believe that the future is bright.
Oh yes, of course.
I want you to comment on that point. I thought, as a country, how do you think we are progressing? There are issues, there are problems. But is there a ray of light which can expand itself?
So I had mentioned that despite all that I have said, I am quite amazed as to where we are in 70 years. So there is no reason to believe that that trajectory will get interrupted. No question about it. Yeah.
For all the young people who are here.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. There's no question about
it.
All I'm trying to say is that the rate at which technology is galloping, if we have to remain relevant, there have to be more hands on deck and more talent. If each of us decides to realize our individual potential, whatever it may be, more than enough. And that is our demographic dividend.
You know, as a journalist, I would like to ask many, many questions. This is the last and the last and the last. You know, I just want to sign off in a lighter note. Does Rakesh Sharma get angry anytime? Our cosmology, in a sense, you know, we don't know because
wife gets angry at Rakesh Sharma.
All right, okay, all right. Okay, so how does a cosmonaut encounter his wife?
By saying, Ji Huzoor.
Somebody told me that, you know, there are times when you have watched Bollywood movies, you cried.
I find that as I'm getting older and older, I find it very easy to cry. I'm becoming more and more emotional. I find that for myself. I go to attend the wedding of my friend's daughter and I start weeping because my daughter's also got to get married. That's also an art. Today's movies are, there's so much of talent. The directors are so good. They know how to manipulate the emotions. They know how to strike a chord. They're great communicators. Yeah, so it affects, I mean, I'm sensitive.
All right, so guys, I hope you guys enjoyed. That was Coffee with a Cosmonaut. Yeah? All right.